remembers that famous Damien. He said to his friend, if the British march by land or sea, from town to night, hang a lantern aloft in the belfry arch of the North Church Tower as a signal light, one if by land and two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore will be, ready to ride and spread the alarm through every Middlesex village and farm, for the country folk to be up and armed.
Then he said good night with a muffled oar, silently rode to the Charleston shore. Just as the moon rose over the bay, pursuing the ride at the morning's light, the sunless British man of war, a victim ship with a mast and spar, across the moon of the moor, and a huge black hole that was magnified by its own reflection of the world. Meanwhile, his friends in the alley and street wandered and watched with eager ears, until in the silence surrounding the ears, the mustard man of the barracks door and the sound of arms returned to the mouth of the measured tread of the neighbors, marching down to the western shore. Then he climbed to the top of the old church by the wooden stairs with a stealthy tread to the belfry chamber overhead, and startled into the shrunken birch on the tumble after it that round him made, fast in wing shapes of shade by the trembling ladder steep and tall to the highest window in the wall. Very thoughtless and looked down, a moment under the roof of the town, and he went floor one of all. Beneath the churchyard lay the dead, in the night encampment on the hill, wrapped in silence so deeply still that he could hear like a sentinel's tread. The watchful night wind as it went creeping along from tent to tent, it seemed to whisper all as well. A moment only feels a spell of the place and hour and spirit dread. Up the lane, belfry of the dead, for suddenly all his thoughts were dimmed by shadows of the far away, but the river riding came into the bay. A line of black red leather floats on the rising tide of the village boats. Meanwhile, a patient and mounted ride, leading his road with a heavy stride. On the opposite shore, walked Paul Revere by patting his horse aside. Now gaze at the landscape, landscape far and near, then a patient stamped the earth and turned to it to stop his birth. Mostly he watched with eager search the lovely child of the old church, as it rose again to the rays of the hill, lonely, lovely and special and something still, and lo, he looks in the lovely head, looking at the blue light. He springs to the saddle with a fire of the turns, building in the mazes to the full sight of second one in the belfry breaks. A hurry of hoofs in the village street, a shape in the moonlight, a hole in the dark, and deep in the pebbles of passing spark, struck up by a sea of pine fields and bleak, that all was any of the blue to the light. Fading was ready in the evening light, and the spark struck out by the sea of the void.
The breaks are coming! The breaks are coming!
Tranquil and broad and deep is a majestic name of the ocean tide, and now under the alley that skirts its edge, now stop on the sand now on the ledge, is heard the tramp of the steed as he rides.
It was 12 by the village clock when he crossed the bridge into Medford Park. He heard the crowing of the cock and the barking of the farmer's dog, and he felt the damp of the river flock that rises after the sun goes down. It was 1 by the village clock when he galloped into Lexington. He saw the gilded weathercock swim into the moonlight as he passed, and the meeting house windows, blank and bare, glared him with a spectral glare, as if they already stood aghast at the bloody work that they would look upon. It was 2 by the village clock when he came to the bridge in Concord Town. He heard the bleating of the flock and the twitter of birds among the trees, and felt the breath of the morning breeze blowing over the meadow ground. And one was safe, asleep in his bed, who at the bridge would be first of all, who that day would be lying dead, pierced by a British musket ball. You know the rest, in the books you have read, had the British regulars fired and fled, how the farmers gave up ball for ball, from behind each fence and farmyard wall, chasing the redcoats down the lane, then crossing the fields to emerge again. Under the trees, at the turn of the road, and only passing to fire and load. So through the night rode Paul Revere, and so the night rang his cry of alarm to every Middlesex village and farm. A cry of defiance and not of fear, a voice in the darkness, a knock at the door, and a word that should echo forevermore. For born of the night wind of the past, through all our history to the last, in the hour of darkness and peril and need, the people will waken and listen to hear the hurrying hoofbeats of the steed and the midnight message of Paul Revere.